talk a thing when you're up on the mountain, but talk comes so easy when life's at its best. But it's down in the valley of trials and temptations that's when things go wrong. He'll
I will not boast in anything. No gifts, no power, no wisdom. But I will boast in Jesus Christ. His death and resurrection. Why should
thinking about this song for a little while, but sometimes we find ourselves in a place where don't really understand the things that are going on, and it's so hard to put ourselves to the side and allow God to do what He needs to do through us. I'm telling you, what this world needs today is a little more humility. So y'all just listen as we try to sing this song. If that's what it takes. This place that I'm in feels so unfair. This weight on my chest seems more than I can bear. I can't see where this is going to end. I'll stay on my knees till then, if that's what it takes, to break my will, to make me still enough to hear your voice. I'll trust in you, oh Lord, if that's what it takes, to realize without you I'm just going the wrong way, live life in vain. Lord, humble me a little more each day, if that's what it takes. This is not the path I'd ever choose for me. Lord, you see the bigger picture, and the man that I can be. So Lord, I'll give you all my fears, and I'll cry a few more tears, if that's what it takes to make me still enough to hear your voice. Then I'll trust in you, oh Lord, if that's what it takes. realize without you I'm just going the wrong way, living life in vain. Lord, humble me a little more each day, if that's what it takes. That's what it takes to give my all and totally surrender to your plan, though I may not understand. Lord, give me strength to make it one more day. That's what it takes. That's what it takes.
Good morning. This thing's hot. Wow. I didn't mean to blow your eardrums out. I talk loud anyway, I guess, so bear with me. I told Scott this morning, he came back, and he and I talked a few moments, and I shared with him. I thought I knew maybe earlier in the week God had dealt with me a little bit, or maybe I was, I don't know that I can say it was God that dealt with me, but I thought I knew maybe which way I would go. And a pastor friend of mine had even talked to me about that, and we'd talked, and I'd told him what I thought I would preach on today. And then I think it was yesterday, and he said, where are you going tomorrow? And I said, what we talked about the other day, what I said, all that's out the window. It ain't going to work. It ain't going to work. And so... I told Scott what my thought was, and that's the reason he led page 127. He started off with that song, How Firm a Foundation. And I just want to go through and read the verses. How firm a foundation, you saints of the Lord. Different people got different ideas about what a saint is. You know what a saint is? A saint is one that has been sanctified by the blood of the Lamb. That means if you've been saved by the grace of God, if you know Him as your personal Lord and Savior, you are a saint. Well, I don't feel like a saint. I don't feel like one either, and oftentimes I don't act like one. But you know what? I is one. Amen? Amen. Because I've been saved. I've been washed in the blood.
Amen.
So he says, how firm a foundation, you saints of the Lord. I don't know George Keith, and I don't know Anna Steck, but that's who they give credit for writing this song. I've not researched it or anything like that, but that's who it says here. You saints of the Lord, is laid for your faith in His excellent word. Y'all agree this word is excellent? All right? We all just agreed that His word is excellent, right? Why is it that oftentimes we don't live by it? Amen? Why is it oftentimes we don't live? Well, we agree it's excellent. We agree it's got all the answers. We agree it tells us how we ought to live our lives, but oh, how often we ignore it. What more can He say than to you He hath said? What more can He say? What more can He give you? Ye who unto Jesus for refuge have fled. And if we've been saved by the grace of God, He is our refuge.
Amen.
He is our refuge. In every condition, in sickness and health, in poverty's veil or abounding in wealth, at home or abroad, on the land, on the sea, as thy days may demand, shall thy strength ever be. Whatever we need for the moment, whatever we need for the day, guess what? It's there, it's available, if we'll just take advantage of it. He says, fear not, I'm with thee. Oh, be not dismayed. I am thy God, and will give thee aid. Isn't that good? Man, I'm telling you, talk about a writer, talk about a song. I'll strengthen thee, help thee, and cause thee to stand. Upheld by my righteous, omnipotent hand. And you know what that word omnipotent means? That means all powerful.
Amen.
That don't, I mean, our God don't have some power. Our God don't have a little bit of power. Our God has all power. And this writer said that he would uphold us by his righteous, omnipotent hand.
Amen.
Y'all understand a little bit? Y'all beginning to get the picture about a firm foundation? What we're founded on and what it's all about? Anything else is going to fall. Anything else won't stand. It's got to be on that foundation. In down the old, listen to this. I love this because I'm getting older every day. Y'all noticed that in the last 13 or so years. I've got less hair and it's grayer than it was probably when I came here. But listen to what it says. In down to old age, all my people shall prove my constant, eternal, unchangeable love. And when hoary hairs, that is gray hairs, shall their temples adorn, like lambs they shall still on my bosom be born. Even though I'm getting older now, even though I've got less hair and it's turning gray, he still holds me like a child.
Amen.
Isn't that good?
Yes.
Isn't that good?
Amen.
You talk about a firm foundation. The soul that on Jesus doth lean for repose. Lean for repose. What does that word mean? Well, I happened to sit there a while ago and look it up. I got to find where I wrote it down. A state of rest, sleep, or tranquility. Don't that sound good? A state of rest. Just a rest. So this writer said, the soul that on Jesus doth lean for repose, doth lean for sweet rest. I will not desert to his foes. Emphasized it twice. That soul, though all hell should endeavor to shake. And I'm telling you, hell is trying to shake us today. Amen?
Amen.
Though all hell should endeavor to shake, I'll never, no, never, no, never forsake. Emphasized it three times. I'll never, no, never, no, never forsake. That's
Amen.
A foundation, isn't it? That's a firm foundation. Amen?
Amen.
Now let's look at God's word and let him speak to our hearts today. It's already feeling good from where I'm standing. By the way, a foundation is the basis on which a thing stands, is founded, or is supported. That's according to the American Heritage Dictionary. A foundation is the basis on which a thing stands, is founded, or is supported. It's what holds something up. That's a foundation. Years ago, when Michelle's sister was about to get married, she and her husband endeavored to build a little house right across the woods from us. Not a very big house, just a little small one-bedroom bath, had a little kitchen, living room area, kind of all thrown together there. But we got over there one day, and the inspector had said when the footings was dug, before they poured the slab, that we had to go, because there had been some field dirt brought in, we had to go ever so many feet, and we had to dig a hole down to solid ground. We had to go through all that field dirt and dig down to solid ground. And every one of those had to be filled with concrete and then the footings and then the slab poured on top of that. So we did that, and some of those holes were probably about as deep as this pulpit stands. And they filled them things up with concrete ever so many feet. And then they came in there and poured those footings. And then they came and poured the slab. And I guarantee you that slab in places is probably 10 inches deep in concrete. And so the joke was, this little bitty house, you could have built a skyscraper on that foundation. I guarantee you. I seen it with my own eyes. I know how much concrete went in that thing. There, man, I'm telling you, you talk about overkill. And that house is still there today, and as far as I know, it ain't moved. Not a bit. It's on a good foundation. A good foundation. Now, I've never been under the floor of this church. Don't know that I want to. I think this building, if I'm not mistaken, was built somewhere around in the 1870s. Does that sound right, Janice? The actual four walls of the structure, the original structure, somewhere in the 1870s. Been here a long time. And they tell me underneath there, like I say, I've never went, but that there's still the rock piers that they built this church on. They're still there today. That was 1870s, and this is 2022. And it ain't gone nowhere. You know why? Because it's on a good foundation.
Amen.
It's on a firm foundation. They dug down right. They fixed it right. They fixed the piers, and it's still standing today. Isn't that amazing?
Amen.
Now let's look at Isaiah chapter 28. Isaiah chapter 28, verse 16. Listen to the words that God gave the prophet Isaiah. Isaiah 28, 16. Therefore, thus says the Lord God, behold, I lay in Zion for a foundation, a stone, a tried stone, a precious cornerstone, a sure foundation. He that believes shall not make haste or be forced to flee, be forced to run. A foundation stone, a sure foundation. We're talking about things, you know, I've talked a lot about the natural. I've talked about a natural foundation, and those are necessary to build upon. But what I want to really emphasize today is a spiritual foundation. We must have a spiritual foundation, because when it's all said and done, it's not our, Jerry read to us this morning in our devotion before Sunday school about how there was going to be folks come up before the Lord on judgment day, and they would say, Lord, we prophesied in your name. We cast out devils in your name. We've done all kind of wonderful works in your name. And the Lord's going to look at them and say, depart from me, you workers of iniquity. I never knew you. I don't know who you are. They weren't on a foundation. They might have had some type of fine home they lived in. They might have been on a physical foundation, but they had no spiritual rock to stand on. They didn't have a foundation. They had no depth. And it didn't work. And Jesus said there'll be those that will stand before him in that day and say, but Lord, I did this, this, and that, and the other for you. And he'll say, I don't know who you are. I'm going to tell you something. That ought to make us quake in our boots a little bit. I tell you what it makes me do from time to time. It makes me do a little checking up. It makes me go back. It makes me test out the foundation. And you know what you find every time? If you're on that rock, it ain't going nowhere.
Amen.
It's still just as solid and sure today as it was the day I first got saved. And I'm going to tell you something. I enjoy it more now than I ever have. I just took advantage of it when I was a kid. I got saved so young, and I really didn't live a Christian life. I just kind of leaned on the fact that I was saved, and that meant I was all right. And if death found me, I'd go to heaven. And that's about as far as it went. But oh, God wants so much more for his people. God wants so much more for his church. God wants so he wants us to enjoy our salvation. He wants us to enjoy being founded on that sure foundation.
Amen. Yeah.
That's what he wants. That word, when he talks about a tried stone, a precious cornerstone, a sure foundation. Guess what? I looked up the word sure. And this is what it says. It's able to be relied on and trusted. I like that, don't you? A sure foundation is it's able to be relied on. It's able to be trusted. That's a sure foundation. They tell me today that the Leaning Tower of Pisa, I've just seen pictures of it. There's a reason it leans. And you know what it is? The foundation wasn't right. The foundation wasn't right. And therefore it leans. And so it's became, you know, now, they probably wouldn't want to straighten it up because it wouldn't be the Leaning Tower anymore, right? It'd be the Straight Tower of Pisa. Who'd want to go see that? But my understanding is it wasn't built on the right kind of foundation. I've heard of other structures and buildings and, you know, and things, and I've heard how that over time they're beginning to sink little by little, and it always goes back to the same thing. The foundation wasn't right.
Amen.
The foundation's not right. And if the foundation's not right, sooner or later there's going to be problems. There's companies in business today, and their primary business, the primary way they make their money, is going in and helping folks fix their foundations. That's what they're all about. That's what they're all about. Well, I'm going to tell you something. Our foundation, the church of the living God, and I'm not just talking about friendship this morning. Our foundation don't need fixing. There ain't nothing wrong with it. It's still sure. It's still sound. It ain't going nowhere. It never has, and it never will. A sure foundation. He that believes shall not make haste. He shall not be forced to flee. The NIV says the one who trusts will never be dismayed. The one who trusts in that foundation will never be dismayed, will never be let down. Never. I'm going to tell you something. Mankind, we let each other down. Yeah. Y'all have heard me say from this very pulpit, I've said it many times, and it's the truth. If I've not already let you down, and I realize I have, but if I haven't let you down yet, get ready, because one day I will. One day I'll let you down. One day I won't do something like you think I should, and you'll be upset with me, and you'll be disappointed. Well, guess what? I ain't perfect. I can't do everything right. I'm going to mess up. But I'm founded on the rock. I'm founded on a sure foundation. And he never messes up. And he never lets me down. And he will never let you down. If you're on the right foundation, let me tell you something. The Bible says he'll make you stand.
Amen.
We preached in the 7th chapter of Micah for several weeks. And I'm going to tell you something. If you went back and studied that any at all, you'd realize Micah was in a tough spot. Micah had been let down. Micah had been hurt. Things had been rough for Micah. But you know what he went back to? Remember what he said? He said, I'm going to look to God. I'm going to look to the Lord. I'm going to wait on him, the God of my salvation. That's what I'm going to do. Yes. And you know why he said that? Because he knew he was on a good foundation. He knew the foundation was sure. He knew it was solid. He knew it wasn't going anywhere. Yeah. The psalmist, in Psalm 118, verse 22, said, the stone the builders rejected has become the capstone. What is a capstone? Well, in the day, sometimes they would use a capstone. Maybe it would be a long rectangular shape or something. They would lay it above the door. That was the capstone. It was like the lintel above the door. They would use a capstone oftentimes to anchor and align the corners of a wall where it cornered. They'd put that capstone, and that would be the anchor, and then they'd build from there. Or it would be the keystone of an arch. And if that keystone's not in the arch just right, guess what? The arch is going to fall apart. It ain't going to stay there. That's what a capstone was. And so when the psalmist said, the stone the builders rejected has become the capstone, what he's saying there is the one that the world rejected, he's the number one. The one that the builders of this world cast aside and didn't want anything to do with has become the absolute most important stone in God's new age that says it is grace by faith.
Amen. Yes.
In the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Isn't that something? Isn't that good?
The Lord.
The one that the builders, the ones the world has rejected, has become the capstone. Jesus used these verses. In Matthew 21:42, Jesus said this about himself. Jesus said to them, have you never read in the scriptures, the stone the builders rejected has become the capstone? The Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes. That's 118, 22, and 23. Jesus said that. He said, you're looking at him. The world will reject me. But he said, the stone the builders rejected, I'm going to be the capstone. God has done this, and it's marvelous in our eyes. Listen, nothing has changed about the foundation. It's still solid. It's still sure. You can still depend on it. It ain't going anywhere. The fact of the matter is, a storm could blow up tomorrow. A tornado could come through and level this little hill right here and not leave one stone upon another. Take his church and just go. It's out of here. Does that mean Friendship Church ceases to exist? Does that mean we just throw up our hands and say, well, we ain't got no church. I guess we're done. Might as well quit. My goodness, if it leveled every building on this property, Friendship Church could still come together and worship and serve the Savior. You know why?
Amen.
Because it ain't about a foundation built out of natural stone. It's about one built on the spiritual rock.
Amen.
It's about Jesus Christ. That's what it's about. Jesus said, have you not read? Do you not know what the Scripture said? Do you not realize he's talking about me? Isaiah 54:10 in the English Standard Version says, for the mountains may depart. Oh, this is good. The mountains may depart and the hills be removed, but my steadfast love shall not depart from you, and my covenant of peace shall not be removed, says the Lord, who has compassion on you. That sounds like a sure foundation to me. How about you? Isaiah said it hundreds of years before Jesus came to this world. He said, the mountains may depart and the hills be moved, but God's love ain't going nowhere, and his covenant of peace, it ain't going to be removed, says the Lord. But why? Because he has compassion. He loves his people. He loves the church. Isn't that good? In 1 Corinthians, there's some scripture I want to share with you in chapter 10. No, I'm sorry. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 11. Listen to what Paul says. He says, and I'm going to tell you something. Read up and study a little bit about the church in Corinth. They had issues. I don't reckon I've ever known a church that didn't. I've never been associated with one that didn't. You know why? Because a church, most of the time, has members that are sinners saved by grace. And I'm one of them.
Amen.
And as long as I'm a part of the church, it ain't gonna be perfect. As long as I'm part of the church on this in this world, it's gonna be something wrong with it.
Amen.
Because I'm a part of it.
Yeah.
But one day, when I go to be with the church up yonder, we'll all be perfect.
Amen.
We'll be just as we should be. One a day. So Paul said in 1 Corinthians 3:11, listen to this. He said, for other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. There ain't no other foundation other than the one that's already been laid, Paul says, and that's Jesus Christ. That's pretty plain, isn't it? That's pretty straightforward, right? Now look at 1 Corinthians chapter 10, and let's look at the first four verses there. He's going to talk about Moses here. He's going to talk about the children of Israel. And this is good stuff. He's going to talk about divine guidance, and he's going to talk about divine deliverance. And listen to what he says. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, four verses. Moreover, brethren, I would not that you should be ignorant how that all our fathers were under the cloud and all passed through the sea. You know what he's talking about? If you've ever read about the children of Israel, when God led them out of Egypt, when he led them out of slavery, guess what? There was a pillar of fire that they followed by night. You know what led them by daytime? It was a cloud. And you know what makes up clouds? It's mist. It's water. That's what made. And that water, that cloud, led them by day, and that pillar of fire led them in the night. So he says, how all our fathers were under the cloud and all passed through the sea. How did they get? They crossed the Red Sea. How did they do that? Because God parted the waters. And they went over, my Bible says, on dry ground. And he says they were all baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea. Now that don't mean, when we think of baptism, we think of a preacher there and he's immersing them in water, right? It's not what it's talking about. They're simply being identified with Moses and his leadership. They're simply being identified as the fact that God, in a sense, brought them out of Egypt. He led them along by that cloud in the day and that fire by night. He led them across the Red Sea, brethren, and the sea closed in on their enemies that they saw them no more. Brethren, that's deliverance. That's identification.
Amen.
And they did all eat the same spiritual meat. What's he talking about there? God fed them with manna out of heaven. That doesn't mean it was a, you know what that means? It was supernatural food. I never ate manna. But they ate it for 40 years. How about that? God provided it. Amen. And listen to this. Look at verse 4. And they did all drink the same spiritual drink, for they drank of that spiritual rock. Now listen, this is amazing. Listen to what Paul says here. We're talking about Old Testament time. We're talking about thousands of years now before Jesus came to this earth. But I want you to hear what Paul said about it. He said, and they did all drink the same spiritual drink, for they drank of that spiritual rock. And my Bible's got it capitalized, rock. And he says, and that followed them, and that rock was Christ. Isn't that good?
Amen.
They're wandering around in the wilderness headed to the promised land. And the Bible says, Paul wants them to understand that rock was Christ that went all the way. You know why? Because Jesus said, listen, he talked to a woman at a well one time. And he said, give me a drink. And she said, you don't have nothing to draw with. Why are you asking a Samaritan woman? Y'all hate us. You Jews hate us, Samaritan. And Jesus said, well, if you knew who you was talking to, you'd ask me and I'd give you spiritual water. I'd give you water, the water of life that would bubble up into life eternal. He's the water of life, people. In another place, he said, they was people scattered out on the hillside, and he took two little fish and five little loaves of bread, and he broke them up, and he fed 5,000 plus men and women and children on that hillside. No telling how many they was when you added them all up, and every one of them ate till they was filled. And Jesus said, he said, I am the bread of life.
Amen.
My goodness gracious, John chapter 1 says, he listen, it says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He said, and the same was in the beginning with God. And he goes on and says, all things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. He's talking about the rock. He's talking about Christ. God's always had a plan. God laid the foundation, and it ain't changed. It's the same yesterday. It's the same right now, today, and it'll be the same if the world goes on another 1,000 years. It'll be the same. It don't change. That rock was Christ. Isn't that good? Isn't that good? Divine guidance. Divine deliverance. 2 Timothy 2:19, Paul says to young Timothy there, a pastor, I believe, that struggled like pastors often do today. And he said, listen to what Paul told him, trying to encourage this man. He said, nevertheless, the foundation of God stands sure. That means it stands steady. Remember I read you the definition of sure? That word sure means able to be relied on and trusted. Remember that? And what did Paul say to Timothy? The foundation of God stands sure, Timothy. It's steady. Having this seal, the Lord knows them that are His, and let everyone that names the name of Christ depart from iniquity. Timothy, God knows who you are. He's given you a solid foundation. You're founded on a rock. He's given you everything you need. The church is going to be persecuted. The church is going to suffer. You're going to be right in the midst of that. But don't you lose heart, Timothy. Don't you lose heart. You tell folks, if they're believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, get away from that iniquity. Get away from that wickedness. Get away from that sin. Run from it. Look at Psalms. I'm about done. Look at Psalms. I'm telling you, church, this is good. Foundation ain't changed. Foundation has not changed. Foundation's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Psalms 18, verse 2 says, listen to what the psalmist said. This is a psalm of David. And let's begin with verse 1. I will love thee, O Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer and my God, my strength in whom I will trust, my buckler and the horn of my salvation and my high tower. I'll call upon the Lord who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from my enemies. David knew the rock upon which he stood. And brethren, David made mistakes and David messed up. But he always went back to the rock. Because he knew it was a sure foundation. You don't need to change. The foundation is sure. Ain't nothing wrong with a foundation. Ain't nothing wrong with a foundation. Psalm 61. Wow. Psalm 61, David again, you know what he says? He said, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. Isn't that good?
Amen.
Lead me to the rock that is higher than I. Why? Because I know that foundation's solid. I know it ain't gonna move. And now that brings us to Luke chapter 7. And listen to this. Oh my goodness. Oh, listen. Luke chapter 6. Listen to these words of Jesus. Jesus said, whosoever comes to me and hears my sayings and does them. Somebody that comes and don't just hear, but they actually do something with it. They don't just hear. They're not just a hearer of the word. James talks about if we're just a hearer of the word and not a doer of the word, then we're just deceiving ourselves. We're just lying to ourselves, in other words. If we say we're hearing the word, but we're not doing anything with it, we're just lying to ourselves. We're deceiving ourselves. And Jesus said the same thing. He said, whoever comes to me and hears my sayings and does them, I will show you who he is like. This is good. He's like a man which built a house, and he dig deep. You remember me talking about digging them holes ever so many feet, digging down to that solid foundation. You remember me talking about that? He's like a man which built a house and dig deep, and he laid the foundation on a rock. And when the flood rose and the stream beat vehemently upon that house and could not shake it.
Amen.
Could not shake it. And you know why? Jesus said, for it was founded upon a rock. It ain't going nowhere. You know what? Jesus said these words with the assumption that the storms were going to come. Jesus said these words knowing with absolute certainty that it was going to happen.
Amen.
And that's why he said you better be founded on a rock. Because the storms are going to come and the winds are going to blow. And depending on the foundation is whether or not it's going to stand. Ain't nothing wrong with a foundation. Do we get it? Ain't nothing wrong with a foundation. It's what we build on it sometimes that gets messed up. But the foundation is sure and solid, and it ain't going nowhere. Verse 49 says, listen now, serious words. Jesus, again, he that hears and does not, you hear the word, but you don't do anything with it, is like a man that built no foundation, like a man that didn't go out and dig down to the rock, like a man that just went out and threw his house up on the dirt. I watch sometimes on TV and sometimes I'm thankful I live in Georgia. Not because, I mean, let's just be honest, if you look at statistics, Atlanta, our capital city in the state of Georgia, is one of the most horrible places for human trafficking that there is. There's so much lostness in certain zip codes in metro Atlanta, it's unbelievable. And yet, we're supposed to be the very buckle of the good old Bible Belt of the South. That's gone right out the window. Ain't because there's anything wrong with the foundation. Foundation's solid. Foundation's good. Foundation ain't going nowhere. It's not the foundation's not the problem. Right? It's not the problem. But I watch the news things, and California burns up, and all the undergrowth is burned, and then the rains come, and the mudslides start. And I've seen pictures, horrible, awful pictures of acres and acres with nothing, absolutely nothing left, as far as I can see, but the charred remains of forest and foundations. No homes there. Foundations. Homes gone. Wiped out by the fires. I've seen other times when homes were caught up in the mudslides and just destroyed. Not necessarily because the there wasn't built on a foundation, but simply because the land that even the foundation was built on just wasn't stable, and it just collapses, and it takes those homes away. Tragic. Tragic. But I'm telling you, we need to understand today, in the Church of the Living God, founded upon the rock, founded upon Jesus Christ, the church will be here when the Lord comes back.
Amen.
It will be here when the Lord comes back. Because there's nothing wrong with a foundation. Now you can go to Revelation and you can read about 7 different churches that Jesus addressed. He had a different message for every one of them. And most of them had issues. I think there was maybe 1 or 2 that he didn't have much negative to say about. For the most part, they had issues. He told one of them in Laodicea, and I read up, and I thought this was interesting, where the springs come from certain places. They were hot springs, and then there was cold mountain streams that come from another area. But by the time they got together, the water had just become lukewarm. And so when Jesus told the church in Laodicea, he said, you're not hot, and you're not cold. Now, hot water can refresh you. Ain't nothing better than a good hot shower. When you've been out working and it just cleans you up, makes you feel good. Ain't nothing more refreshing than a good cold drink of water. But you know what Jesus said about the church in Laodicea? He said, I wish you were one or the other. I wish you was hot or I wish you was cold, but since you ain't neither one, you're just lukewarm. They would have immediately understood and known what he was talking about. Who wants to drink lukewarm water? Makes you want to vomit, don't it? And Jesus said, I'll vomit you out. And that word is a violent word. It's like gushing. Gushing. Like John Clark used to do when he was a baby. Gushing. Gushing. That's what he said. He emphasized that. Because you're not hot, because you're not cold, because you think you've all got it, you've got it all wrapped up, and you think you're just hot stuff, he said, I'm just going to vomit you right out. I'm going to spew you out of my mouth. My goodness gracious. Wasn't because they weren't on a foundation. Their foundation was there. What they had been founded on was sure. It hadn't gone anywhere. They had just chosen not to build on it. They'd become self-centered and self-satisfied. God forbid that we, the church, become self-centered and self-satisfied.
Amen.
God forbid it becomes about me and not about Jesus Christ.
Amen.
God forbid it becomes about what I want and I fail to build on the foundation that he's given me to build on. So he says, he that hears and does not, it's like a man that without a foundation built a house upon the earth. He just throwed it up on the dirt. Against when the stream did beat vehemently, that is heavily, and immediately it fell. And listen to this, it gets worse. It fell, and not only did it fall, it said, and the ruin of that house was great. It was a tragedy. The ruin of that house was great. Great was the fall of it. My Bible had a little footnote that said terrible. Terrible. It was a terrible thing. And it's all because they weren't on the foundation. The foundation is Jesus, people. You're either founded on Jesus or you're founded on nothing. This world is not going to get you anywhere. No amount of money in the bank. I don't care if you come to church. I don't care if you don't miss a Sunday in a year. I don't care if your name used to, when I was a kid growing up, the church gave Sunday school pens for perfect attendance. And I've known people that had pens hanging down to their belly button from perfect attendance. Well, you know what? They can stroll up before Jesus one day with their pins hanging to their belly button and say, I never missed a Sunday in 25 years, Lord. I went to Sunday school every Sunday. I was there. And Jesus might very well say, I don't know who you are. Depart from me, you worker of iniquity. I don't know who you are. Because if you're trusting in your Sunday school pen, you're trusting in the wrong thing. Preacher, I've read my Bible. I read it every year. I read it from Genesis to Revelation. Every year I read my Bible. Every year. Well, that's great. But are you on the foundation? Are you founded on the rock? Do you know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? I was raised in church. My grandparents helped found this church. I've been here as long as I can remember. Are you founded on the rock? Is Jesus Christ your personal Lord and Savior? I don't care how many churches you're a member of. Are you a member of the family of God? Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Have you been baptized? Listen, I ain't talking about water. I'm talking about when I got saved and God placed the Holy Spirit of God. You know, we used to call it the Holy Ghost. Don't say that much anymore. People says, folks is afraid of ghosts. Let me tell you, you ain't got nothing to fear when it comes to the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Lives and dwells within me. The foundation. The solid rock. That same rock that went along with the children of Israel in the wilderness. That same rock, Paul said it was Christ. Went right along with them. Well, how could that be? He hadn't even come to earth yet. Let me tell you, don't you believe that he's the Son of God? Don't you believe he left the splendor of heaven and came here and put on flesh and became one of us so he could know and experience what we experience, so nobody could ever say, Lord, you don't understand? Because he can say, I do understand. I've been there. I know what you're going through. I know what it is to be rejected. I know what it is. I've been there. Are you founded on the rock today? Are you just founded on your church membership? Church membership never got nobody to heaven. People talk about, they want to say, what religion are you? Well, what religion are you, brother? What religion are you? I say, I don't have religion. They kind of look at you, you know, they about to start witnessing to you, trying to get you saved. I don't have religion. I have a relationship.
Amen.
You know who it's with?
Hallelujah.
That rock. Christ. Do you have a relationship today, or have you just got religion? Tis the old time religion. Tis the old time religion. Tis the old time religion. It's good enough for me. It's good enough to send you to hell. Blasphemy, preacher, blasphemy. That's one of them old hymns that stood the test of time. Blasphemy, preacher. I'm just telling you, if all you depending on is old time religion and you ain't found it on the rock, Jesus will say, depart from me. I don't know who you are.
Amen.
Now, if you've got it and you've been saved by the grace of God, then you can say, makes me love everybody, makes me love everybody, makes me love everybody. It's good enough for me.
Amen.
That'll work, won't it? That'll work. I like it when the Spirit gives me boldness. I like it when it won't let me quit. I like it when God says, preacher, you're done when I say you're done.
Amen.
Quit looking at your watch.
Amen.
I like it when God says somebody might need you to go another minute or two longer. They might need to get saved today. They might need that little extra oomph to make them get up and move. Come on, everybody, stand up with me. Come on, Scott, sing for us. What are we going to sing?
We're going to sing. It's 390 at the bottom.
Jesus, my 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 Jesus, my
That'll work, won't it? That'll work. There's another verse, right? Sing it. Thank you for being here today. Thank you for praying for this service today. Thank you for our Sunday school numbers being at 89 today. Isn't that something? Wow. Wow. Love it. Love it. God bless you is my prayer. Please, please, please go praying. Come back praying. If you've got your money for your barbecue and stew tickets and all, I know that Lee is taking that up today and some others. Jamie, yeah, and make sure you get that to them, and look forward to a good time. Those things pretty much sell themselves. As soon as people finds out Friendship's doing the barbecue and all, they start asking. They want a ticket. So we hope that that turns out really good, and all of it goes for church camp. Wonderful, wonderful thing, and we're looking forward to that. If you ain't signed up for church camp, you need to do that too, right? Need to sign up for church camp. We've had reservations now for 3 years at Pinnacle, and we're just praying to the good Lord above. We're going to get to use them this time. So sign up for that. All hearts and minds clear. Raise your hands up high. You sure, Brenda? All right. All right. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
You're free to go.